Dear Mr. President, dear conference, first of all, I would like to make a captatio with the volunteer. I would not read all my text that I have written, so I try to be filling that 18-minute gap. The 17th century is a significant period in the Hungarian ecclesiastical history. The historiography of the preceding century was heavily marked by the defeat of Hungary in the Battle of March. Historians try to explain the trauma caused by a tragic defeat in a way that would not put blame on any of the churches. It was God's will and God's punishment for the ungodly life and behavior of the priest and of the clergy in general, or because the various reforms that too part the church, the holy role of the Christ. Each church tried to emphasize the narrative which was the most suitable and right for them. However, these histories are not religious or ecclesiastical in any sense, besides pointing at each other and putting the blame on the other for being responsible for the defeat at Monarch. This writing did not fulfill the characteristic of ecclesiastical historiography. By the turn of the century, historiography has undergone major changes in terms of both quantity and content. On the one hand, the number of historical works increased, first on behalf of the Protestants. Then, at the end of the century, a strong increase in number can be observed on the Catholic side as well. On the other hand, the historical issues of the Protestant Reform come to the foreground, which, however unintentional, leads to religious polemics. First, Peter Basman, the humanist Catholic bishop, presents his interest in the history of the Hungarian Reformation. Then, in the 60s-70s, the decades of persecution of the Protestant churches in Hungary, largely contributed to these changes. The enormous losses suffered by the Protestant side forced them to register and make an inventory of all the material and spiritual losses. Churches, schools, states, properties, and priests. Moreover, the inhuman treatment of the Protestant pastor galleys slaves, an event that had great resonance to go to Europe, increased the already prevailing interest of European scientific community in the history of Reformation in Hungary and Transylvania as well. The first complete history of the Hungarian Protestant churches was written by Ferenc Paris Papai in 1684 with the title Hudus Redi. Following Papai, and thanks to foreign encouragements, Papai and the Latin writes the Historia Ecclesiae Reformatae in Hungaria at Transylvania around 1706. However, the works was not published during his lifetime, only later in 1728, when Friedrich Adolf Lange, the professor from Utrecht, published his work under his name. Plagiarism was already present in that time. Pahor is the most prominent figure of Hungarian Calvinist history, and besides ecclesiastical historiography, his work also extends to the popular journals of that time. He was born in 1601 in Debrecen. Here he finished his studies at the famous college. He continued his studies at Leiden, Franeker, and most probably, and he has been to Utrecht and Amsterdam as well. Debrecen fell victim to the epidemic of the plague in 1710. The work of the scholar for the priest is a comprehensive work on religious history, the aim of which is not simply to write about the history of Hungarian Reformation, but to present this history in the context of universal Christianity and to prove that Hungarian Christianity originated from the early Christian era. It is interesting the way the author depicts the beginning of Hungarian Christianity at the beginning of his works. It seeks to shed light on the question of the origin of Hungarian Christianity in the light of Scythian Han-Hungarian origin theory. The Scythian Han-Hungarian relationship is in fact a medieval construct. It is not even a Hungarian idea, since there are earlier sources from antiquity denying the Hungarian lineage. It was advantageous for the Christian Hungarian state formed after the Hungarian conquest to identify themselves with the Scythian origins. On the one hand, it was flattering to identify with such a famous ancestor. On the other hand, there was the European belief according to which all nations coming from East to Triton Europe were in fact somehow brought to punish the sinful Europe. The 17th, 18th century historiography, which has already become polarized based on religious affiliations, built its arguments almost exclusively on this theory of origin. In the language above, in Nepertin's work, the title of the first chapter is as follows. I quote, "The Pannonian origins of the Christian Church can be traced back to the sacred history." Concerning to the early Christianity of the Scythian, he states, I quote, "It is believed that around 45 AD, St. Andrew preached the gospel to the Scythian apostles. This was proven among other historians by St. Jerome, his work entitled De Scriptoribus Ecclesiasticus. And however, there are others who believe that essentially the apostle preached the gospel to these cities. If we look after, there is another work by St. Jerome with the above quoted title. Order Genevius continued Jerome's work with the title De Scriptoribus Ecclesiasticus. Therefore, the two works are often mentioned with the same title. Unfortunately, after analyzing St. Jerome's work entitled De Viribus Justus, we cannot find any reference of this kind. Neither Jerome nor Ignatius, who continued this work, wrote about the biography of St. Andrew. The name of the apostle is mentioned in three places within his work, but not in such context. It can be easily constituted of a wax. This statement might seem valid, however, it is worth analyzing why the name of St. Jerome appears in such a context. The reference of St. Jerome's work is closely followed by the work of Eusebius entitled Historia Ecclesiastica. This seems logical because the theory of Scythian apostolic Christianity is largely attributed to the name of Eusebius, who laid the foundation of this theory in his ecclesiastical history. According to Eusebius, he took this information from Origen. As the original work of Origen has not survived, we could as well believe Eusebius' words. However, we also need to take in account Hildeberg arguments according to whom Eusebius cites and refers to several famous historians slowly in his literacy and authenticity of his own works. In this light, we can agree with Harnack's previous statement, according to which Eusebius did not cite directly from Origen's work, but the informations come from tradition, from the Christian paradoxes. Moreover, it also worth noting that Origen himself drew a lot from these paradoxes. If we examine our sources from early Christianity, it can be seen that in the first century there was no sign of St. Andrew's apostolic work in Scythia. We can already find some data about St. Andrew in the second century, but these are connected to Patras, the place where he was crucified and where, during this period, the special cult of also develops. A major change occurs in the 3rd century, when more and more works of apocryphal literature appear. The primary purpose of these works was to establish religious tradition parallel to the official ecclesiastical tradition in order to prove the antiquity and true Christian teaching of the various heretic movements. For the Levente, St. Jerome remains one of the most credible authors in proving apostolic Christianity of Hungarians. A few lines below the above mentioned quotation, he devotes a larger section to Jerome. To sum up the main ideas of the quotation, please read it on the slide. It can be said that since St. Jerome was born in Scythia, and for a while he lived in Pannonia or its immediate surroundings, he must have preached the word of God among his Hungarian compatriots, and that Huns were also settled there for 65 years. Moreover, St. Jerome's letter to Levente also proves that he was not edified. There have been a lot of debates in identifying the exact geographical location of the city, Sion, and in some cases these were related arguments full of emotion. Placing the town of Sion in the Pannonia region dates back to the 5th century when the Counts of Celle placed monks of the order of St. Paul the First Hermit in their estate. And for the monks who settled there, it was preferable to say that St. Jerome, the first biographer of St. Paul the First Hermit, who was the patron saint of the order, was born in this region. And so as the exact location of Stridon was known, it could as well be placed in Pannonia. In this way, the prestige and the famous of the famous predecessor could boost the internal and external positive image of the monastic community as well. As the city was destroyed by the Goths around 317 AD, the Huns who had invaded and settled in the region around 318 could not see much of the city or its inhabitants. Going through the biography of St. Jerome, it can be seen that in the 318 he was still in the Middle East. In 381 he traveled to the city of the first Council in Constantinople. Between 382 and 385 he was in Rome. Then in 385 he returned to the Holy Land and settled in Bethlehem. In 386, where he lived for the rest of his life. Taking all this into consideration, it becomes obvious that there was little chance or even impossible for St. Jerome to preach the words of God among the Huns, which is the time period mentioned by the letter. And no, I would not like to go more into the detail regarding the issue of language barriers. Furthermore, it is important to look at other places in the text, besides the both quoted excerpt from the letter to Leta, to Foxy referring to the Huns. Regarding to the texts, it is revealed that in fact St. Jerome did not have a positive opinion regarding the Huns. He is terrified when he thinks of the evil deeds committed by them. He is afraid of the threatening human invasion. He speaks of human hordes. Only in the letter to Leta, also quoted by the Retinue, does he depict the Huns as singing them songs. This is also doubtful because there is a lack of not only archaeological but even literary evidence of Huns' Christianity. Analyzing St. Jerome's geographical knowledge and concepts, Susan Weilgarten states that this concept of geography relies on the beliefs and works of previous Roman authors. Even if the Jerome map so popular in the Middle Ages has nothing to do with St. Jerome, he must have had some kind of linear map of late empire, a kind of itinerary pictum similar to the tabula poetica. This is also suggested by the fact that when he presents people and nation outside of the empire, he follows a linear route from east to the west, similarly to the migration route. See the little 60, Scythia, Thracian, Macedonian, Dardanian, Dacian. All this leads to the conclusion that the Scythians are indirectly the Huns, were not in Pannonia, but somewhere around the Caucasus, as they are listed after the Armenians and are followed by people who are closer to the center, Rome. Ammianus Marcellinus, historian of the late Roman Empire, plays an important role in depicting the Huns as barbaric people. He devotes a separate chapter of his historical work to the Huns and writes in detail about them, generally portraying them in a negative light, such as barbarism, the non-plus ultra of the cruel Eastern Normans, in spite of the fact that he never had seen a Hun in his life. St. Jerome was familiar with the works of Ammianus and cited him when he wrote about the Huns' strange eating habits. Thus, Jerome did not create, as we have pointed out above, a big picture of the Huns from his own experience, but he relied on the literary tradition in this case as well. In the light of this, we can have some doubts regarding his information about the Christianity of the Huns and Scythians as well. E.A. Thompson, in a brief study, analyzed the validity of and success of any missionary work among the Huns. Based on our analysis of the present work, Thompson's conclusion seems to be valid and well-grounded. I quote, neglecting then the vague and rhetorical phrases of Jerome, Borut, and Theodoret, we may conclude that through the 5th century the Huns as a whole remained pagan, and the few individuals whom we know to have been converted appear to have had particularly close relation with the Romans. And this is to emphasize that the Christian faith has been extended to the very end of the earth. As Rome's power extends to the entire orbis terrarum, so does Christianity, neither geography nor nation can create any boundaries, because it is spread all around the world. It is how it all sounded good to the reality was quite different. Early Christianity also had its own geographic concept, which has not much different from the sometimes propagandistic geographical approach of the Roman Empire, but transposed it, mutatis mutandis, to its own rhetoric to fit the given context. Thus, they no longer proclaim the greatness of pagan Rome, but the glory of the Christian faith in God. All in all, we can say that the blazing Christian faith that Jerome speaks of in his letter did not really exist, but it was only a fancy topos rhetoric, and this topos came to the fore in the era of the Protestant Catholic religious fervors in trying to answer the important question, where was your church before Luther? From the Protestant side, a plausible answer was to emphasize that the given people, the Hungarian, in our case, the Hungarian, had already converted to Christianity in the apostolic age, and that the Hungarians did not actually receive the Christian faith from the Roman Pope, but from the apostles, and the Calvinists had only continued this faith. In order to prove the above, Protestant historians referred back to the most credible sources, to the Church Fathers accepted by both sides, Catholic and Protestant, such as Saint Jerome, interpreting their text so as to fit their needs and purpose. Thank you for your